me thank Peter for his gracious introduction, but more importantly, I think we all owe him a huge debt of gratitude, not only for surviving in the current House of Representatives, but for flourishing. Peter, thank you so much. Wife Jane and daughter Karina are so pleased to be here and to congratulate the honorees for the awards that they have received tonight, and to thank Dottie and her staff. Things like this, events like this, do not happen without a whole lot of work, and we thank you all very much for making this event possible. We're all very proud and excited that Senator Leahy's and my colleague Elizabeth Warren is here with us. And I want to tell you something. I knew Elizabeth Warren before she was Elizabeth Warren. I knew her when she was a near law school professor and a writer of very good books. And she came to Vermont to do a couple of town meetings with me. We did one in Montpelier, and we did one at the law school in South Royalton. Thank you, law school. And what struck me then, and strikes me now, her strength is that she can take complicated economic issues that the American people have got to understand and translate economics into English. And that is a significant achievement. She's doing a great job in the Senate. We're delighted that she's here. It would be incorrect of me not to tell you what you already know, and that is that our country today faces more serious problems than we have faced in the modern history of America. And here's the truth. We've got to lay it out there, because we can't go forward lest we deal with reality. And the reality is that the middle class of this country is disappearing. The reality is that we have more people living in poverty today in this country than at any time in the history of the United States. The reality is that in America today, we have more income and wealth inequality than any other major country on earth, and more than any time since just before the Great Depression of the 1920s. That's where we are today, and that's not all. Real unemployment is not really 6.2%. If you include those people who have given up looking for work and are working part-time, it's close to 12%. Youth unemployment, 20%. African-American youth unemployment, close to 40%. And as Elizabeth will no doubt talk about, we have a situation where hundreds of thousands of young people cannot afford to go to college, and others are leaving school $25, $50, $100,000 of debt, go to medical school, make that $200 or $250,000. And on top of all of that, we have a United States Supreme Court that has ruled that corporations are people and that billionaires are now able to buy elections and buy and sell politicians. And that is why we have got to overturn Citizens United through a constitutional amendment. What we are engaged in right now is not just an economic struggle and a political struggle, it is most profoundly a moral struggle. Peter Welch's colleagues in the House, with a straight face, tell us that in the time of huge income and wealth inequality, the most pressing problem in America is to give more tax breaks to the wealthiest people in this country. We say no. Paul Ryan and his friends on the Budget Committee, despite the fact that one out of four corporations in America pays nothing in federal income tax, they think these guys need more tax breaks, and we say no. We who voted against the war in Iraq, and let me tell you, your congressional delegation voted against the first war, and we're going to vote against any other war in Iraq. But we do understand that despite the fact that Cheney and Rumsfeld and all those guys decided to send our young people to war in Iraq and a never-ending war in Afghanistan, we do not hold responsible the men and women who put their lives on the line. And that is why we understand that taking care of our veterans is a cost of war. If you can spend $6 trillion sending people to war, you can spend a few billion dollars taking care of them when they come home. Now, in a couple of weeks, or next month, the Majority Leader of the U.S. Senate, Harry Reid, is going to bring something really important onto the floor of the Senate. And that is a constitutional amendment to say that the Koch brothers and other billionaires will not buy American democracy. I want to thank Governor Shumlin and the Vermont State Legislature for standing up and saying that we need a constitutional amendment. They are joining 16 other states and hundreds of cities and towns in Vermont and throughout this country. And our job in the coming months is to mount an unprecedented grassroots movement, because let me tell you, this is not just a progressive issue. Honest conservatives know that there is something wrong when the second wealthiest family in America can spend hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars on dishonest 30-second ads. That is not the democracy that people fought and died to defend. And when we talk about the issues, we can never for a moment forget, if we're going to look our kids and our grandchildren in the eye and say, yes, unlike the Republicans in Congress, we believe in science. And when the overwhelming majority of scientists who have studied this issue tell us that climate change is real, it is caused by human activity, it is already causing devastating problems in our country and around the world in terms of drought, floods, extreme weather disturbances. We understand that we must, for the sake of this planet, transform our energy system away from fossil fuel, move to energy efficiency and sustainable energy, and in doing that, not only save the planet, but create millions of decent paying jobs. Now these are tough times for the country. But I ask folks to think back about the history of our country. Never forget, I was up at Derby Line a few years ago, and they were having a ceremony honoring World War II veterans, and I was surprised and delighted to see so many of them there. And a young lady got up with a video. She played a video of Franklin Delano Roosevelt speaking on December 8, 1941. You all know what that was about. The United States was then going to war taking on Hitler, taking on Japanese imperialism. We weren't prepared to do that. And yet in 2.5 years, because of mobilization, because of focus, because of good leadership, in literally two and a half years, that war was won. And if we could do that in 1941, we can, in fact, address the serious problems facing our country today. And when you get depressed a little bit, which is not an unnatural response to what is going on, I want you to think about this. If we were sitting here 20, 25 years ago, and somebody said, you know, I think in 2008 this country is going to elect an African-American president, and 4 years later we elect that person, you would have been thought to be crazy. And if you would have thought that 20, 25 years ago when the United States Senate had one woman, that today there would be 19 and that number is going to go up and up, you would have been caught. And let me tell you this, as we celebrate the life of David Curtis, if we had talked 20 years ago and said that in America we would have state after state supporting what Vermont led, and that is gay marriage, somebody would have really thought you were crazy. But all of those things have happened. Point being that the world changes. And what today seems far-fetched and distant can, in fact, happen if we are prepared to make it happen. And our job in this small state is to do what we have done so often on so many issues, and that is to lead America in a very different direction. We're going to create jobs. We're going to have the highest minimum wage in the country. We're going to defend a woman's right to choose. We are proud of the fact that we are leading the nation in gay rights, in your right to know what you're eating, and in many, many other areas. So in this great moral struggle that we are engaged in, we say proudly that America belongs to all of us and not to a handful of billionaires. And we say proudly that every American, led by the state of Vermont, is going to have health care as a right of being an American. Last point. The most important people in the room today are not the folks who are coming up here speaking, it's you who are back there. What the pundits tell us is that in this coming election, 60% of the American people are not going to vote, 70 to 80% of young people and low-income people are not going to vote, while the billionaires are going to spend hundreds of millions of dollars. And what our job is, and what you have done year after year after year, and I congratulate you, because your names don't get in the paper, you're not on TV, but you're out there knocking on doors, getting on the phone, explaining the issues to people, and getting them out to vote. And let's lead the country in voter turnout in November as well. It is now my distinct pleasure to introduce someone that everybody in this room knows and admires, somebody who has a very important and difficult position in Washington now as chairman of the Judiciary Committee, somebody who very quietly, we see it in D.C., but the rest of the country doesn't, is doing an extraordinary job in making sure we have high-quality judges throughout this country, an enormously important issue. who is playing a leading role in helping us get a constitutional amendment to overturn Citizens United, who has been active on net neutrality, who has helped lead the effort in terms of immigration. My pleasure to introduce to you U.S. Senator Patrick Leahy.